Hello students, today we are going to do the Factories Act 1948. Here we will study the provisions related to safety of workers described in Chapter 4 of this Act, the Factories Act 1948. These provisions are described from Section 21 to Section 41 of this Act. Now, the contents of this presentation are the introduction for second, various provisions related to safety of workers. We will study these provisions in detail, and lastly the conclusion. Now, coming to the introduction, in the case of factory workers, physical safety plays an important role as they are subject to physical threats during the work. So it becomes necessary for the law to mention certain fixed safety measures for the workers. As the workers are physically involved in doing work in factories, so the law or the constitution has maintained several rules and regulations in keeping the view of safety of these workers. Now, these provisions are described in Chapter 4 from Section 21 to Section 41. These various provisions are: Section 21 tells us about fencing of machinery. Fencing of machinery means how the machinery which is in motion is to be guarded by fence. Then Section 22 tells us about the work on or near machinery in motion. Section 23, how employment of young person on dangerous machines is done. Then Section 24, striking gear and devices for cutting off power. Then Section 25, self-active machine. Section 26, casing of new machinery. Then Section 27, prohibition of employment of women and children near cotton openers. Section 28 tells us about the various provisions related to lifts and hoists. Then Section 29, lifting machines, chains, ropes and lifting tackles, how they are to be used in the factory. Then Section 30, revolving machines. Section 31, various pressure plants, provisions related to various pressure plants. Section 32, how floors, stairs and means of access should be maintained. Then Section 33, pits, sumps, openings in floor, etc. Section 34 tells us about the excessive weight. Section 35, protection of eyes, how protection of eyes has to be done. Then Section 36 contains provisions for precaution against dangerous fumes, gases, etc. Then Section 37A, precautions regarding the use of portable electric light. Section 37, explosive or inflammable dust, gas, etc. Then Section 38, precautions in case of fire. Section 39, power to require specification of defective parts or test of stability. Section 40 tells us about how safety of building and machinery can be done. Section 40A tells us how maintenance of buildings is to be done. Then Section 40B tells us about the safety officers, how they are appointed and what are their duties and responsibilities. Now we will do these sections one by one. Coming to the first section, that is Section 21, fencing of machinery. Now, in every factory where a motion or transmission machine is used, in that condition, fencing is a must. The speed of the automatic moving machine is very high and it creates the danger of the life of workers. But we remove fencing with proper safeguard while it is necessary to oiling or lubricant. When belt mounting or shipping time, we also remove the fencing of the machine. So, in every factory where a motion or transmission machine is used, in that condition, fencing is must, and as the speed of these moving machine is very high, as well as if oiling or lubricant is required, at that time we can remove this fencing with proper safeguards. Now, next, Section 22. Section 22 tells us about when employees work on or near machinery in motion, what precautions or what is allowed for them. Now, if any worker is working near a motion machine and on the motion machine, then proper clothing should be provided. The only adult male is allowed can work on a motion machine. No young person or woman can work on a motion machine or near on that motion machine. Now, if any adult person works on mounting a belt, then the length of the belt is not more than 15 centimeter. Now, if belt length is more than 15 centimeter, then the worker denies during doing work on the machine in a time of mounting check that belt joint is joined properly or not. It should be checked to take all precautions when any person works on the machine. Every precaution has to be taken when any worker or employee is working near a machinery in motion. That is to wear proper clothes and to maintain proper distance. Now, coming to the section 23. Section 23 tells us about the employment of young person on dangerous machines. In ordinary condition, young persons are not allowed to work over the machine. But if they are allowed, they are trained by a very supervisor, very knowledgeable person, and that young person has to work under the control of the supervisor or supervision of a trained person. Now, coming to the section 24, striking gear and devices for cutting off part. There are some machines in the factory which are run through gear. In a gear mechanism, there is a separate switching box. So, the switching box must be outside that room where the gear mechanism is running. Second, gear of machine and switch on or off the button, they should must be covered. When a person is going to work on the machine, then it is necessary to check that gear must be in neutral. The switch of the gear box is off. The name of the person who is going for work must be registered under the register maintained by the employer. Firstly, switch off the gear and lock them after the person is allowed to do work on the machine. A person standing nearby switches, his duty is to check that everything is okay or not. The speed of the gear mechanism is very high. If we do any negligence towards it, then it could cause the death of the worker who is working on the machine. So proper care should be taken for switching off and on of these gear devices. Now, coming to section 25, that is self-acting machine. Now, self-acting machine speed is very high. So, where the machine is established, it needs to leave a space. The person who is employed in the factory or not maintains distance from the self-acting machine, the distance between machine and passages should be 45 centimeter in every industry. The chief inspector feels that there is no maintenance of rule, then passes an order to follow the rule in that area. If the chief inspector sees that there is no distance of 45 centimeter between the machine and the passage, he can ask the company to maintain it and follow the rule. Now, coming to the section 26, that is casing of new machinery. When a new machine is installed in a factory, then measures to be adopted by the employer. All screw, bolt or key or any revolving shaft, wheel or pinion or spindle must be in a proper way. Seller or hire check all the safety measures. Gear and various parts of the machine must be covered by the keys so that it cannot harm the worker of the factory. Now, after the commencement of this act, all rules and regulations followed by the employer were made by the state government. After installing the machine, some employees are trained by the employer to run a machine so that worker can take all precautionary measures and no dangers, and there should be no danger on the health of workers. Now, coming to section 27. Section 27 tells us about the prohibition of employment of women and children near cotton opener. Now, first let me discuss what are cotton openers. These cotton openers are machines for picking, shaking and blowing baled cotton and forming it into fleecy lap. Now, in a factory of cotton where there is work of cotton opener, is done, no women or children are employed. First of all, they should not be employed. Second, women and children are in separate room of cotton opener. They are allowed to work on the cotton end portion, that is that opener, opener end portion. Now, the inspector has to check that no women or child works in cotton opener as part of the factory. Otherwise, he is given notice to the occupier of the factory. Otherwise, he can give notice to the occupier of the factory. Now, coming to the section 28. Section 28 tells about the various hoses and lifts which are to be used in the factory. Now, what is hose? Hose is a device used for lifting or lowering a load by means of a drum or lift wheel around which rope or chain rests. It's a kind of pulley. Hose and lifts made of strong materials, so they are capable to bring heavy materials, means they should be made up of strong material. Then a competent person should check the hose and lifts in every 6 months at least, and the register is maintained in which all the entry is mentioned of an examination. The way of hose and lift is covered with an enclosure and the gate is used to prevent the person's entry. This enclosure was also made by a sound material, the enclosure which is enclosing the hose and lift. Then there is a maximum limit of every hose and lift, so no overloaded hose and lift should be used. If a hose and lift are used to carry a person, then it was covered by a gate on both sides so that the person must be safe in the hose and lift. To pull the hose and lift, two chains or rope are used by the employer for the safety of workers. Efficient equipment is used to control the gauge. The state, if the government, the state government is not satisfied with the condition of the hose and lift, the state government can give the order to maintain it properly because it is very necessary for the safety of workers. Now, coming to the section 29, that is lifting machines, chains, ropes and lifting tackles. How they are going to be used in a factory. Any mechanical system for lifting or pulling specially, an arrangement of ropes and pulleys designated to lift heavy weights. Any lifting machine must be made by sound material. Then, chain ropes are made up of good materials so that we can use in construction and other industrial purpose. Then, a competent person must regularly check these lifting machine ropes and lifting tackles at least in every 12 months. And for this also, a register is maintained. Then, the chief inspector checks the register at any time, so it should be properly maintained. Now, coming to the next section, that is section 30, that is revolving machinery. How they are going to be used in any factory? What are the laws related to the revolving machinery? Now, the grinding process is done in any factory so that there is a necessity to establish a machine on that premises or nearby that. In any factory in which grinding process is done, revolving machinery becomes an essential. The grinding speed is very high, and if anyone comes in the contact of the machine, then it causes the death of the person. Now, the diameter of the machine must be secured so that it cannot harm the workers. State government prescribes the speed of machine. No one can exceed that speed. Those instruments who are revolving by self, the speed of these instruments were also maintained, like a revolving vessel, cage, basket, flywheel, pulley, etc. A proper speed mentioned by the state government has to be maintained of these revolving machinery. Now, next provision is related to pressure plant. Now, if any machine is used in a factory that is run by pressure more than atmospheric pressure, then effective measures shall be taken by the employer for the safety of the for the workers. Now, for the examination and testing, state government may make rules regarding pressure plants. The state government can also adopt various safety measures regarding the safety of workers. The state government also exempts any industry or plant for the provision of this action. The state government has the power to exempt any industry which it thinks fit from the given provision. Now, coming to the section 32, that is floors, stairs and means of access. How they should be maintained in any factory. When the product is ready, then the stock is placed in free space. It is not the right way to use this technique. When the stock is pending, then it settles down by employer in upstairs floors, etc. In the factory, there is easy access to the way to leave free space. In any factory, in every factory, there should be free space for easy access to the way. The state government makes safety measures regarding floors, stairs, and means of access. It was made by a proper contraction and also maintained properly. Now, section 33, pits, sums, openings in floors, etc. What are pits? What are pits? Are generally the hole in the floor of the factory. Sums are the pits where liquid collects, okay, in a factory. Now, pits, tanks, sums, and opening floor must be covered properly because of the depth, construction, or content. These are created because they can create a danger to the workers who are working near it. The state government may also exempt some industry or plant or class to this provision by giving the order in writing. Now, coming to the next provision, that is section 24, excessive weights. If in any factory no one carries excessive weight so that it causes injury to the person, no employer can load a heavy weight on worker. Now, in here also, the state government prescribes the maximum weight lifting by any adult men, adult women, adolescents, and children employed in factories. They are fixing the various classes of industries or any description of factories. For different classes of industries or factories, different weights are being prescribed. Now, coming to the section 35, that is production of ice. In a factory where the manufacturing process creates the particle in the air and also some explosive light comes from the manufacturing plant, this can affect the eyes of the worker. So, proper safety measures was adopted by the employer to protect the eyes of the worker. The state government provides an effective screen or suitable goggles so that the eyes of the workers remain safe. Now, coming to the next slide or next section, that is section 36. Now, precautions against section 36 to section 38 deals with various precautions which are to be maintained in the factory. Section 36 deals with the precaution against dangerous fumes, gases, etc. Here, it tells us about that no person is allowed to enter any hole, pit, or tank if they are filled with dangerous fumes and gases because it is dangerous to human health. Then second, the person is permitted to enter any pit, hole, and tank where the dangerous fumes are in permeable form. Before sending any person in dangerous fumes vapor, firstly, it was checked by a competent person. Competent people doing tests and giving certificates. After that, the person is allowed to enter any kind of chamber. First, it is checked, and then the persons who are competent, they are given certificates. If they are allowed, if they have the certificates, they can move into that pit or hole. Now, a person who is entering any kind of chamber or pit, they bear all the safety measures, that is safety clothes. He is securely attached by a rope on one end of rope carried by the person who is outside the pit, and he will manage the rope properly. All apparatus and safety measures should be adopted while any person is entering any hole, pit or tank which is filled with dangerous fumes or gases. Now, coming to the next section, that is section 36A, precaution regarding the use of portable electric light. In pit and chamber, there is no facility of light. So, the workers are allowed to take a light with themselves. The voltage of light is not more than 24 volt. Here, the voltage is described, that is, it should not be more than 24 volt. Otherwise, it becomes dangerous to the health of the workers. Now, next section is section 37. Section 37 tells us about various provisions related to explosive or inflammable dust, gas, etc. coming out in the factory. Now, The manufacturing process in the factory produces any kind of dust, fumes, gases, and vapor depending upon which product that factory is going to manufacture or manufacturing. These gases, dust, and vapor are inflammable and produce ignition. Then these types of process must be stopped, or that plant or manufacturing process should be enclosed properly so that it cannot harm any person. Now, all prevention measures should be adopted properly and effective enclosure of dust, fumes, and gases should be done. Now, Section 38. Section 38 tells us about the various precautions in case of fire. If there is a case of fire, then what precautions a factory has to maintain? In the factory, all preventive measures should be available at the time of emergency. All the workers of factory should be trained that how they are going to escape at the time of the fire. The extinguisher is at the factory in everywhere. The time to check the fire validity of extinguisher and their expiry date should also be there. Proper guidelines will be provided to the worker at the time of emergency. Now, all effective measures here also, all effective measures should be adopted so it will help to spread the harm in the place. Now, coming to the next section, that is section 39. Part 2 requires specification of defective parts or test of stability. The inspector sees the condition of the factory. If he thinks that there is something dangerous to the safety of workers, then inspector in writing gives the order to the manager and order occupier of the factory, and we specify the date of all testing related to machine and building. Now, before the expiry of the date, all managers or occupier does all the specified result and report to the inspector. Inspector does all these inquiries because for the safety of the workers. Now this inspector, chief inspector, can ask the manager and occupier to do the testing of the various machinery which he thinks are not fit, and they have to do this, and again they have to report to the manager that they have done the required check. Now, section 40 relates to the safety of building and machinery. The inspector checks all the industries, manufacturing plants, machine, and there is any danger to the health of workers. All effective measures should be adopted to take precautions. Inspector has given notice to the manager or acquirer of a factory that is there is any danger to the worker, then this type of building is closed immediately. If manufacturing plant or machine is dangerous, then it is also stopped from any manufacturing process. Now, coming to our next section, that is section 40A, maintenance of buildings. Building in which the factory or manufacturing plant or machines are running should be properly maintained. If the inspector thinks that this causes danger to the life of worker, then an inspector in writing, even notice to the manager or occupier of the factory to repair that building, otherwise shift to another building. The manager, the chief inspector, gives the option to the manager or the occupier if he thinks that building is can be dangerous, that building can be dangerous to the life of the worker, he can give the notice to the manager or occupier either to stop work from that building or to shift to another factory. Now, coming to the section 48, section 40B, safety officers. In a factory, if 1,000 or more than workers are working, then the employer has to hire a safety officer. In any factory in which more than 1,000 workers are working, that factory has to hire a safety officer. This safety officer helps the worker who have inquiry or have injury in the course of employment or disease. Now, the qualification and conditions are prescribed by state government. According to it, employer appoints a safety officer. Now, section 41. power to make rules to supplement this chapter 4, that is provisions related to safety of workers. This section is supplementary. If there are any other measures adopted by the state government for the safety of workers, then the state government do it under this section permits. State government has the power to make rules and supplement this chapter whenever it thinks fit. Now, coming to our last slide, that is conclusion. That is, the safety measures and health measures are very important for the workers. In India, the number of industries is increasing day to day, and it was necessary that we can take care of the health of workers. Various factories and industries do not follow any rules and regulations which causes danger to the life of the workers. According to this act, there should be an inspector who is appointed so that every factory does their work properly and take proper measures to safeguard the safety, safeguard the health of the workers, as well as to look into the safety of workers. To the Factories Act 1948, here today we will do the meaning of welfare. Provisions related to welfare of workers in the Factories Act 1948 and the concept of working hours as prescribed in the Factories Act 1948. So today we will learn about the meaning of welfare as well as the provisions related to welfare given in the Factories Act 1948 and the concept of working hours as prescribed in the Act. Now, starting with the meaning of welfare, what does this welfare mean? In general terms, welfare is nothing but the health, happiness, and fortunes of a person or group. Some people consider it as a statutory procedure or social effort designed to promote the basic physical and material well-being of people in need. Means it can be physical and material well-being of people in need. Now, people working in different sectors and at different levels have different welfare needs. So, the workers working in the factories too have certain welfare needs. The Factories Act 1948 defines certain provisions regarding this concept. And in this presentation, we will look at all these provisions. Now, coming to our first provision, that is given in the section 42, washing facilities. This section states that every factory should firstly provide and maintain adequate and suitable facilities for washing for all the workers in the factory. Secondly, provide separate and adequately screened facilities for men and women. Thirdly, make accessible all the facilities to all the workers. First, proper maintained and adequate and suitable facility should be there. Second, there should be separate facilities for men and women. And third, these facilities should be accessible by all the workers. Now, the state government may, in respect of any factory or class of description of factories or of any manufacturing process, prescribe standards of adequate and suitable facilities for washing. Now, coming to our next provision, that is given in the section 43, facilities for storing and drying clothes. This section contests some powers with the state government. It states that the state government has the powers to direct the factories regarding the place of storing the clothes of the workers. Moreover, they can also direct them regarding the manners of drying the clothes of the workers. It applies to the situation when workers are not wearing their working clothes. So, the state here in this provision, state government plays a major role and it can direct any factory for providing this provision of storing and drying clothes. Now, coming to our section 44, facilities for sitting. Now, there are various kinds of jobs in a factory. Some of them require the workers to stand for a longer period of time. There is no doubt that the human power to stand has limits. Now, looking at such case, The factory should provide suitable arrangements for sitting for the workers. This is important because whenever the worker gets some free time, he or she may be able to take some rest by sitting. Now, this is going to enhance their efficiency. Secondly, if the chief inspector finds that any worker can do his work more efficiently while sitting, then he can direct the factory officials to arrange sitting arrangement for him. First, proper sitting arrangement should be provided. And if the chief inspector thinks that any worker can do his work more efficiently while sitting, then he can direct the factory officials to arrange sitting arrangements for him. Now, these are the provisions related to facilities for sitting given in the section 44 of the Factories Act 1948. Now, coming to our next provision, that is section 45, first aid appliances. Injuries are somehow an inescapable part of life for the workers, especially working in the factories. Now, looking at the safety and welfare of the workers, this section provides that the factory should provide and maintain proper first aid boxes at every workroom. And under this act, the number of boxes should not less than one for every 100 or 50 workers. Moreover, the first aid boxes should have all the relevant contents according to the act. So, wherever the number of workers are 100 or 50, there should be one first aid box in between them. There should be nothing except the prescribed contents in a first aid box, and each box should be under control of first aid in charge, who will handle all its requirements and its utilization. The in charge should be an expert in first aid field. Now, in the case the number of workers exceeds 500, then the factory should arrange an ambulance room with the availability of all necessary equipments. So, if the number of worker is 100 or 50, there should be first aid, one first aid box in between them. And if the number of workers exceeds 500, then the factory should arrange an ambulance room with the availability of all the necessary equipments. Now, coming to the next section, that is section 46. It contains provisions regarding canteens. This section states that every factory where the number of workers exceeds 250, then the state government may direct the factory owners to provide and maintain a canteen for the workers. Moreover, the government may lay down certain conditions in the construction of canteens. For example, the standards in respect of construction, the food steps to be served, the date by which such canteen shall be operative, the constitution of a managing committee, the delegation to chief inspector subject to such conditions as may be prescribed. So, in any factory where the number of workers are more than 250, one canteen should be there, and the various standards of these canteens will be provided by the state government. For example, like foodstuffs, at the date by which such canteen will be operative, and various constitution of managing committee for the canteens, and various provisions related to this canteen section. Now, coming to section 47, shelters, restrooms and lunchrooms. This section states that if the number of workers in a factory crosses 150, then the factory owner should construct and maintain shelters, restrooms and lunchrooms for the workers. It allows the workers to eat the food which they bring along with them. So, if the more than 150 workers are there, every factory should construct and maintain shelters, restrooms and lunchroom. Further, provided that where a lunchroom exists, no worker shall eat any food in the workroom. The shelters, restrooms and lunchroom should be properly ventilated and lighted. The state government may prescribe the standards in respect of construction, accommodation, furniture and other equipments. Now, coming to section 48, the last sections regarding the welfare provisions. This section provides for the crèches. Now, Due to workforce diversity nowadays, women participation is increasing in all the sectors, especially the industrial sector. Now, one of the factors that stops women to work in factories or any other sector is lack of care for their children during their working hours. In order to solve this problem and increase the engagement of women in factories, Section 48 states that where number of women workers exceed 30, then the factory should arrange a special room for the worker kids who are below the age of 6 years. So, if any factory where the women workers are more than 30, the factory should arrange a special room which will work as a creche for the workers kids who are below the age of 6 years. And moreover, these rooms should be properly lighted and ventilated. Now, coming to our concept of working hours in Factories Act 1948. Now, first of all, first learn what is working hours. Working hour is nothing but the hours for which the worker or employee are under a job. It can be on a daily basis, weekly basis, or monthly basis. Means how much hours a worker is spending in a factory while working. Earlier, the job description was centered around the pay or the salary. But now, since the quality of the work is also important for the worker, the aspect of working hours plays an important role in deciding to opt for a job or not. In order to protect the workers from the exploitation of the factory owners in respect of factories are in the respect of working hours, the Factories Act 1948 states some provisions related to it. Now, these provisions are, first, the first provision is given in section 51 and it is related to weekly hours. This section lays down the maximum limit on working time for a woman in a factory on a or for a worker in a factory on a weekly basis. It states that no factory would ask the worker or make them work for more than 48 hours in a week. So no worker is allowed to work more than 48 hours in a week according to the section 51 related to weekly hours provision provided in the Factories Act 1948. Now, coming to our next section, that is section 52, provides for the weekly holidays. This section states that no adult worker shall be required or allowed to work in a factory on the first day of the week. But this provision applies subject to certain condition. Firstly, he has or will have a holiday for the whole day on one of the three immediately before or after the relevant days. Secondly, the manager of the factory has before the said day or the substituted day under the clause. Means for a worker there will be allowed to work in a factory on the first day of the will not be allowed to work in a factory on the first day of the week, but in certain cases when he is working on the first day of the week, he will be given a holiday for the whole day on one of the 3 days immediately before or after the relevant day. Now, coming to our section 53, that is compensatory holidays. This section states that if in any case the factory in under any provision cuts off a holiday of the worker, then the factory is under due pressure to give the same number of holidays to the workers within the time period of 2 months. Means if the factory is cutting off any holiday of the worker, then the factory is directed to give the same number of holidays to the workers within the time period of 2 months. The state government may prescribe the manner in which the holidays will be given. Now, coming to section 54, it is related to daily hours of work in a factory. This section is nothing but the extension of section 51, keeping in view the weekly working hours limit prescribed by section 51. This section states that the limit on a daily basis. It states that a factory should not allow a worker to work for more than 9 hours per day. The maximum limit can be increased in certain cases after the permission from the chief inspector. For weekly, there should not be more than 48 hours, and on daily basis, the worker should not be allowed to work for more than 9 hours. Now, Section 55. Section 55 deals with the rest intervals. This section states that maximum time for which a worker will work before the interval time period is 5 hours. The interval needs to be of a minimum half an hour. In certain cases, the state government may exempt some factories from this limitation. Means after 5 hours of working, in an interval period of minimum half an hour should be given to the workers. Now, section 56, spread over. Spread over means overlapping of working hours. Looking at the human limitation in working, this section states that the periods of work of an adult worker in a factory, including the intervals for rest, should not spread over more than 10.5 or 10.5 hours in one day. The chief inspector has the power in writing to extend the time period to 12 hours a day. Now, in any factory, a spread over period means overlapping period of two shifts should not be more than 10.5 hours in a day for any worker, as well as the chief inspector can extend this limit of 10.5 hours to 12 hours in certain special cases. Now, coming to section 57, that tells us about the night shift. It states that if any worker works after midnight, then the provision of holidays of section 52 means weekly holidays, and section 53, that is related to compensatory holidays, will be applicable for 24 hours after his shift ends. Moreover, the extra hours after midnight will form part of the previous day only. Now, the section 59 tells us about the overtime and extra wages. This section rewards those workers who are trying to work for more than the maximum time. It states that those workers who work for more than 9 hours a day or 48 hours weekly, he or she is entitled to be paid at double wage rate than the ordinary wage rate for the extra time. He will get the double wages per hour basis. Now, the ordinary wage rate includes only the basic salary and the allowances. It does not include the bonus and other perks. Moreover, the factories need to maintain proper registers for the details of the extra time of the workers and the payment made to them. Now, section 60, double employment. Means no worker is allowed to work in two factories at the same time. It is known as double employment. This section states that no worker is allowed or required to work for more than one factory in a day. In other words, if a worker is working in a factory on a day, then he cannot work for another factory on the same day. Now, section 61, notice of periods of work for adults. This section states that the factory manager should paste a notice on the walls of the factory about the time period of the workers. Moreover, the manager has to comply with the time limiting sections like section 52. In case the worker don't have to work at the same time, then the manager should specify the time of their work and the timing of their work. Then last, the section 62, register of workers. This section states that the manager of the factory to maintain a register about the details of the workers of the factory. It includes names of the workers, work nature, specific formal groups of the worker, etc. Moreover, no worker can work in the factory unless his or her name is given in the register. Now, these are the various provisions related to factory workers working in a factory, related to their working hours as well as related to their welfare facilities. Now, let us revise what we have done. We have done the meaning of welfare, then provisions related to welfare of workers in the Factories Act and the concept of working hours. Now, let us revise these welfare provisions. First, we have done what is welfare. By welfare, we mean various basic physical and material well-being of people in need. And for this, Factories Act provides certain provisions to look after the workers working in factories. These provisions are related to washing facilities, then facilities for storing and drying of clothes, then facilities for sitting, then first aid appliances, then canteens and shelters, restrooms and lunch rooms, crèches, and then comes your concept of working hours in factories. Now, according to working hours, these weekly hours should not be more than 48 hours for a worker. Then weekly holidays, the first day should be declared, first day of the week should be declared a holiday. Then compensatory holiday, if the worker is working in any holiday, then he should be given a compensatory holiday for that within the time period of 2 months. Then daily hours of work should not be more than 9 hours, but the maximum limit can be increased in certain cases after the permission from the chief inspector. Then rest intervals, before the interval time period is 5 hours. That is, a worker is allowed to work for 5 hours. After 5 hours, it should be given, he or she should be given an interval of half an hour, minimum half an hour. Then spread over means, if a worker is working in two shifts, then the working hour should not be more than 10.5 hours spread over. Then in certain cases, the chief inspector has the power in writing to extend the time period to 12 hours a day. Now, coming to night shift, if it states that if any worker works after midnight, then the provisions of the holidays of section weekly holiday and compensatory holiday will be applicable, and these hours after midnight will be counted in the previous day only. Then overtime and extra wages. If the worker is working overtime, then he will get the extra wages, and these extra wages will be paid at double wage rate than the ordinary wage rate. Then double employment, that is, no worker is allowed to or required to work for more than one factory in a day. Then notice of period of work for adults means the factory manager should paste a notice on the wall of the factory about the time period of the worker for the workers. Then moreover, the manager of the factory is required to maintain a register about the details of the workers of the factory. It includes names of the worker, work nature, specific formal groups of the worker, etc. Moreover, no worker can work in a factory unless his or her name is given in the register. Now, this was all about your Factories Act and the provisions related to the welfare of the workers as well as the working hours. Thank you, class.